Hello and welcome to a very special edition of Saturday Night Fried. Special because this is the very fourth programme in the series. That's right, this is Saturday Night Fried number four. To celebrate this exciting anniversary, I've collected together a group of people, some familiar, some quite reserved in their manner, with whom we can enjoy the occasion. We shall be looking back over the past 4 weeks and examining some of the changes in society and the world that we've monitored here in the Saturday Night Fry studio over that period. I have with me one of the original Saturday Night Fry team who was with me when we made our very first broadcast 4 weeks ago, back then in April 1988. I shall be introducing that horny veteran in a moment, as well as some of the newcomers to the programme. But first, because you're lovely, I'm going to play the theme tune that we've used for every single one of our broadcast transmissions. Here it comes now.
Now, if you've ever been down to New Orleans, then you can understand just what I mean. Now, all through the week it's quiet as a mouse, but on Saturday night they go from house to house. You don't have to pay the usual admission if you're a cook or a waiter or a good musician. So if you happen to be just passing by, stop in at the Saturday Night Fish Fry. It was rockin'.
A few memories awoken there, I should imagine. Right, well, let's see who's round the Green Bay's table today. I should explain to you, listeners, that in honour of the occasion, we're all wearing April 1988 clothes. It is hard to believe we ever looked like that back then, isn't it? dear me. Now, first off, a man who back then appeared on the very first programme, Hugh Laurie. Hugh, I'm going to start with a nasty surprise for you. I want you to cast your mind back to that first programme. This is what you sounded like. You'll have to forgive the poor quality of sound.
Hugh, hello. Good afternoon to you, Stephen. Now, Hugh, tell us something about yourself. Stephen, I've worked extensively in both television. Mm-hmm. What sort of characters are your speciality, would you say?
I like to work younger character actors. Rustics, passed-over majors, and embittered paediatricians.
I see.
Well, there we are.
Oh, my goodness. Did I really sound like that?
Well, you did. We all did. So, tell me, what do you think's happened to the world 4 weeks on?
Oh, I don't know, Stephen. Shoot me down in cold blood, if you will. But it seems to me there was an innocence then, you know?
Mm.
It was a time when, I don't know, when everything seemed possible. The world was somehow a purer place.
Mm.
It's not just that you could get £2 worth of jelly babies for less than a fiver, or that you could leave your wife unlocked if you went shopping. It was, I don't know, as I say, an innocence.
That's right. Mind you, I mean, let's not say that there haven't been improvements over the week.
Oh, good Lord, I'd be the first to concede that.
No, the second. I just conceded it, didn't I?
Yes. Yes, quite right, Stephen. I'd be the second to concede that.
Yeah, you might as well be accurate over these things, don't you think?
That's right. If you attend to the small details, the broader sweep will look after itself.
That's rather well put.
Thanks.
So, anyway, you'd be the second to concede it.
That's right.
Concede what exactly, was it?
Well, to be honest, I can't remember what it was that I would be the second to concede.
Well, while Hugh is desperately trying to remember just exactly what it is that he would be the second to concede, let me turn to Jim. Jim Broadbent, actor, ontologist, amateur ice cream, and some say the most able chief constable Dorset never had. Yes. Jim, you started to involve yourself in Saturday Night Fry roundabout episode number two, didn't you?
2 weeks ago now, Stephen, yes.
Yeah. Do you have any interesting thoughts about what's happened since?
Provoking thoughts, certainly. Interesting, I'm not so sure.
Wow.
You see, it's my contention that basically we haven't changed that much at all.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes, on the outside, life has got better. Better, well, I'm not so sure. Faster, let's say. But underneath, I think we're the same poor, naked, frightened, whimpering souls we always were.
Well, you were certainly right to doubt that these were going to be interesting thoughts. They aren't at all, are they, Hugh?
Gut-scorchingly tedious, Stephen.
That's right. Well, go on, Jim.
You see, you can clothe yourselves in finery, you can drive about in loose cars and fast women, but who are you fooling at bottom?
Well, let's hope we're not fooling anybody at bottom, Jim. Hey-ho, who's our final companion today? Well, it's appropriate that we should welcome a newcomer to what has already become known as the programme, a woman who for some time now has been one of our most highly regarded Alisons. The world of arts and entertainment has produced quite a few Alisons over the years. Alison Lurie springs readily to mind, I suppose. Alison Moyet, the pop singer, is on quite a few people's lips at the moment, I know for a fact. Malcolm Alison, surely the nation's favourite ex-Manchester City manager. And we've not been behindhand in sending quite a few Steadmans into the world as a nation either, have we? Ralph Steadman, the cartoonist. Fred Steadman, who played for Surrey as lower-order right-hand batsman and wicket-keeper until he was sadly gathered to God in a railway accident in 1918. And, of course, the Reverend Henry Charles Plumer Steadman, who got his cricketing blue for Cambridge in 1871 and went on to play for Leicestershire and Bedfordshire That was, of course, before Leicestershire was a first-class county. But I think I'm right in saying that there's only ever been one prominent Alison Steadman combining two great artistic traditions. Alison, welcome. Played much cricket?
Stephen, it's sweet of you to ask. As a matter of fact, I've had little to do with the game recently. Mm-hmm. I used to open the bowling for the Drumgool Irregulars in the 70s, a scratch charity team composed of playwrights, bathhouse attendants and shadow home secretaries, but that was some time ago.
What sort of bowling?
I was pretty much seam-up military, medium. Had a top spinner I was proud of and could swing it both ways if conditions were right.
Good stuff. I suppose some of the shadow home secretaries you played with were interesting to meet. Did Reginald Maudling ever figure on your side?
Never Reginald, sadly. Merlin Rees turned out for us a couple of times.
Did he?
Yes, one of the best specialist gullies I've ever seen in the amateur game. Yeah. He was no slouch at short forward square either, though, of course, that was Arnold Wesker's favoured position.
Of course. Well, excellent. Well, we must talk some more, Alison, but first of all, some music. Hello, I'm Himbert Fox, and as the funeral music from Act 3 of Wagner's Götterdämmerung fades away, it's time for In Rehearsal, the programme where we visit prominent stars of stage and screen and talk to them about the rehearsal process. Last week, we spoke to Elvin Arscloth about his approach to dance. Today finds us outside the rehearsal room of London's Royal Opera House in Floral Street, Covent Garden, to talk to Mastingua Condoriosis Bleve about her forthcoming role as Isolde in the Royal Opera's new production of Tristan and Juliet, opening tomorrow, and to the distinguished director, Pert Groyne, and the tenor who will be singing the part of Siegfried, Dame Peter Dischmeister. Let's go in now, shall we? Hello there.
Would you take over that record, please?
Right, well, hello there. First of all, thanks to all three of you for agreeing to take part in the programme. I know this is a very busy time for you. If I can turn first to you, Pert Groyne. Mm-hmm. Another production of Tristan and Juliet?
I think this work is something each new age must reassess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's Dame Peter Dischmeister there, just practising a little. But you caused quite a storm of controversy by setting your production of La Traviata in mid-19th century Paris.
But that is where the story is set.
Well, yes, but surely most directors would set it in Nazi Germany or occupied Bratislava or in a sausage factory in Chicago in the 20s or something like that.
Well, I was keen to show the story in context.
Do you do these productions set in the context that the composer intended just to shock the audience?
Well, obviously, I want an audience who is used to seeing Traviata set in Fin de Siècle Brazil or Stone Age Basildon to look again at the work, to re-examine it, if you won't.
Yeah, but 19th century Paris, I mean, aren't you afraid that people would just look on it as a gimmick?
That is a risk I am prepared to take.
I see, thank you. Well, then, we can look forward to a production of Die Meistersingers set in Nuremberg and a version of Don Giovanni set in Seville next. Intriguing thought. Mastingua Condoriosis Bleve, if I can turn to you. You've played Isolde once before in New York, I think it was, and to some extent that was the part that made your name, though I'm bound to say names like yours are born, not made. What's it like returning in a new production to a role you know so well?
It's a challenge. Mm-hmm. It's special, and it's a challenge. It's a special challenge. It's specially challenging working with people as special as Pert and Peter. They are very special. But then I think everyone's special in a challenging, special kind of way.
Everyone's special?
Oh, I think so, don't you?
Not really. It doesn't make much sense, does it? I mean, if everyone's special, what's so special about being special? Special would just mean normal.
That's what's so special.
Right. So, tell me, how do you rehearse a part like Isolde?
It has to be something you work out inside. You know, it must go on inside. If you rehearse outside, it might be raining, there might be traffic. It's very important. Always to be indoors, in a room.
I see. Dame Peter, if I can bring you in.
He's already in. He likes to work inside, too.
Peter, opera, despite a recent vogue, is still quite an elitist form of entertainment. Does that worry you?
Well, you know, I'm hearing on all sides that opera is only for the rich. But I have to tell you that if I'm to walk down the street, then there are hundreds of ordinary people who are coming up to me and requiring that I am signing their pornograph books. And these are not people who are full of monies in their jean pockets, you know. These are the run-of-the-hill Covent or Garden folk of the world.
Well, that's a healthy sign. Where did you learn your singing?
Well, I am for 5 years at the school in Berkshire, where I was singing in the school choirs. And from this I was going to the Guildhall Schools of Music.
So you've lived in England for some time?
All my lives.
But your parents brought you up speaking German as a mother tongue.
German?
Well, you are German principally, of course.
No, my mother is coming from Hemel Hempstead.
Oh, and your father?
My father is coming from Bradford. He should be here any minute.
Well, perhaps we can end with a piece of music of your choice, Miss Lingua Condoriosis, please.
There is an aria that is very special to me.
Well, we'll hear it anyway. And as the Queen of the Night's aria, Der Herrliche Rache kocht in meinem Herzen, from Mozart's The Magic Flute, fades away, it's time for that part of the programme we call In the Bath With. And this week I'm in the bath with Lord Marshall of the Central Electricity Generating Board.
Hello.
Hello. Well, let's start the tap running with a simple question about... What? Well, I see, it was a joke. Oh, dear. And now you want me to get out? I'm sorry, I don't want to spoil the joke. So, it's straight on to the next part of the programme. Towel. Thank you. Which we call Stephen will do his level best so to contrive events that your desiderata shall and will come to pass. Or, as it's fast becoming known in the wine bars and youth clubs of the land, SWDHLBSTCETYDSAWCT.
P.
P. And our first letter is from Sally Joseph of Northwood Hills, aged 8. And she says... Dear Stephen, will you fix it for me to visit Wonderland and meet Alice and the White Rabbit? Don't be stupid. Lord Marshall?
Yes?
We finish with you now.
Oh, jolly good.
A more constructive missive arrives from a Mr. Sobey of Malvern. Dear Stephen, your programme is a load of rubbish. Why can't we have some decent programmes, e.g. Fat Man on a Bicycle? Well, Mr. Sobey, sim salabim. Hello, welcome to Fat Man on a Bicycle. There's my bicycle, and here's my enormous fat paunch. Oof. And this week, Fat Man on a Bicycle visits the lovely Cotswold village of Stafford Hildred. But first, I'm going to pop into the newsagent to buy some sweets, leaving my bike outside. Ah, now, what have we here? A boost, a topic, some munchies, which should maintain my weight at its present excessive level... Do they still make spangles, I wonder? Ah, hello, shopkeeper.
Hello, fat person.
And what's your name?
Hugh Laurie.
And would you like to hear some music?
I've already heard some.
Splendid. So, as the bonny Scottish sun sinks slowly behind the braes, the good folk of Clochmaddoch seek refuge in the Purple Heather Social Club, as do I, squeezing my huge, wobbling love handles between the frail jambs of this traditional gathering place. And here I'm with the charming manageress of the Purple Heather Club. What's your name, madam?
Hugh Laurie.
I see. And how long have you been running this place?
26 years, since just after my husband died.
So... Hugh, if I might pause briefly to shift my immense bulk from one enormous buttock to the other. What sort of age groups do you get coming here? Oh, never mind. And here I am in the Hindu Kush. Yes, it is a bit chilly, but no matter, because I have with me a ferocious-looking gentleman who is, in fact, one of the area's local guides. And as my blubbery haunches spread over the sides of the rock I'm sitting on, may I ask you your name, sir?
Hugh Laurie. Oh.
Well, we've finally arrived in Cornwall, giving Hugh plenty of time to exercise his imagination on the subject of appropriate names. And we're outside the smallest church in Britain. Outside, because I'm so fat I can't get in. Blubber, blubber, wobble. So, instead of the vicar, I'm talking to the village's only traffic warden, whose name is...
Valdemar Janucek.
Look, Hugh, are you going to take this seriously?
It's Valdemar, actually.
You're supposed to be a Cornish traffic warden, not the art critic of the Guardian.
Well, I like that. You're supposed to be Fat Man on a Bicycle.
Well, I am.
You're not fat.
I am.
You're thin and tweedy.
Quiver, quiver, wobble, wobble.
Oh, stop it. And where's your bicycle?
My... Oh, jings! It's outside that newsagent in Stafford Hildred. Doh! No. Well, what fun that was. Join us again next week for Fat Man on a Bicycle, or as we call it, FMOA.
B.
B. Yes, Jim, what is it?
It's Lord Marshall on the phone.
Yes?
Of the Central Electricity.
Yes, of the CEG, yes.
B.
Of the CEGB, yes, yes, what does he want?
He says, could you send a taxi round with his clothes?
And as the overture to Wagner's Tannhäuser fades away, it's time for Face the People. I'm Gladwin Price. Every week we invite a prominent journalist to face a panel of people to explain their profession and what they do. Our press-ganged guest this week is the tabloid editor Sandy Ratcreep. But first, our panel. From the world of publishing and self-promotion, we welcome Hecate Carbide.
Good evening.
From the twin worlds of sodomy and knitting, the author and virgin Trim Kite. Good evening, Trim.
Hello.
That's our panel. Now let's meet our pressman. Sandy Ratcreep started as a cub reporter on the Daily Graphic, though occasionally you were allowed to report on scout meetings and some brownie events, I understand.
That's right, Stephen, yes.
Mm-hmm. From the Graphic, you moved quickly to the Sunday Star and thence to the News of the Week and the Daily Sun. For the Daily Sun, you specialise in raking up secrets about the famous and writing leaders. You're 25, married with two children.
Correct.
Right, well, there's your pressman. Panel.
Sandy, hello. I suppose the first question I must ask, you must get this all the time, is how do you sleep at nights?
How do you mean?
Well, I'm just thinking, putting myself in your shoes, really. You spend your days making people immensely unhappy, writing vulgar and disgusting prose and demeaning this country and its population. I was wondering if this made sleep difficult at all.
Wait. Who do I make unhappy?
Well, I would have thought the people you tell lies about, the people you tell unhappy truths about, their children, friends and loved ones, and those who simply have a higher regard for humanity than you do. You certainly make me very unhappy.
Me too.
And me.
No, look, it's my readers I'm concerned about. The odd rich celebrity can take a bit of knocking from time to time. I like my readers to have a laugh, though.
So it's all pretty harmless stuff,
Sandy. Of course, yes.
Harmless, Jim?
Yes, interesting. It may be harmless, I don't think it is, actually, but it's really you I'm worried about, your immortal soul.
Well, that's typically patronising.
Yes, I know, I'm awfully sorry, but I really am curious. You see, I don't know anybody, human being that is, or indeed animal, who could dedicate their life to something as sordid, disreputable, vicious and cruel as you do. I was just interested. I was hoping that perhaps you were from another planet. Is that it?
I don't have to take this.
No, of course you don't.
Look, I'm doing a job. Somebody's got to do it.
No, I didn't think so.
Well, plenty would take my place if I didn't.
Is that a happy thought, I wonder?
We're here to sell papers, and if that's what sells them, you know, then that's fine.
Oh, I see.
Right.
Look, my editor tells me what to do, and I do it.
Just sort of following orders, in fact.
Oh, that has a familiar ring to it, that place, doesn't it?
It seems to me you're a pretty sort of unhappy and ghastly man. Is that fair?
You see, I can't picture it, you know. Presumably once you were a happy little boy with a mother and father, you liked ice cream, had a little bike, a hopeful little human being, and now...
A whole life thrown away.
Wasted on envy, hatred, malice, cruelty and spite. It's pity.
Your mother must wonder what she did to have given birth to something lower on the evolutionary scale than a dung beetle.
Well, there you have it, a credit to his species. Yeah. Next week, a guest not for the squeamish, I'm afraid, as we descend one notch lower even than that and ask someone from the Daily Mail to face the people. Until then, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Oh, that's fine, isn't it?
I thought that went rather well.
Didn't mind us having a go at you.
No, it was great. You really had me for a moment.
A good programme, that, I thought.
I enjoyed the bit about the dung beetle.
And as Vivaldi's Gloria fades away, it's time to welcome you once more to Make Up, the game in which three actors make up stories about their careers. Welcome first Tony Delwood, best known, I suppose, for his appearances as the lovable Tony Delwood on Overture and Beginners, the theatre game on Radio 2. On his left, Marlona Grasscock, Radio 4's favourite panellist, star of The Green Room and On Stage, Radio 4's regular theatre anecdote games. And on her right, from Radio's It's Your Cue, Dartney Crabble. So, team, our first round is called Giggles. Malona, you ever succumbed?
Oh, we call it corpsing, of course. There was one occasion I was working with Nicky Truefit.
False. 2 points to Dartney, you've never worked with Nicky Truefit.
It's a fair cop. Anyway, it was the production of Snuggery Snug, and Paula Frint was playing opposite me.
Lovely actress.
Oh, you're lovely. Yeah.
Another 2 points to Dartney. She's revolting.
Anyway, there was a scene Well, she had to announce that she was pregnant, and I was playing her young daughter.
Oh, another two to Dartney. You've never played anyone young in your life.
Oh, dear. And anyway, as she was announcing this very serious moment in the play, and a baby started crying in the audience. Well, I don't know, there was her saying she was pregnant, and suddenly to hear this baby, I just collapsed. It was so funny.
10 points to Dartney, I think, got in there first. I don't think I've ever heard anything less funny in my life. Now, Tony, I want you to listen to this extract from A Lady of Consequence for me. I shall be asking you who the actors in it are, and on a scale of 1 to 10, how lovely to work with each one is. No minus numbers, remember? Okay, here it is.
Miss Fanmount. Harriet, you must by now be aware that the feelings animating my bosom amount to more than those of ordinary friendship.
Oh, Mr. Cunningham, you mustn't say ordinary of friendship. It shows a want of finer feelings. Friendship is like a hemorrhage, exquisitely charming, but easily ruined.
But, Miss Fanmount, what is charming in a hemorrhage?
Do I mean hemorrhage? Perhaps I mean foxglove. But then you flustered me, Mr. Cunningham, when you talked this way.
I am sorry, Miss Fanmount. Sorry from the bottom of my heart.
When the word bottom enters a conversation, I always feel chilly.
Your beauty has wiped the power of speech from me, Harriet. You are like an angel. I hope it will not offend you if I say that the giddy divinity of your presence inspires me, provokes me, quickens me, maddens me.
No, I am not in the least offended by your saying that. If you were to say that I caused you to feel most horribly sick, then I think I would be offended. Or that I was a monstrous, turtle-breathed ball of slime. That would hurt me a little, I think. But I cannot be wounded by your saying that I inspire you, provoke you, quicken you, madden you.
Oh, you are quite adorable.
Oh, pray do not call me that.
But you are adorable.
But it is not an adorable thing to be.
When is adorable not adorable?
When it is adorable.
You must forgive me, Miss Fanmount, but can you not see that I love you? Love you with a passion words are unequal to the task of expressing.
I am fully alive to the fact, Mr. Cunningham, but I beg you, don't talk of love. I always think that when men talk of love, they really mean something else.
Allow me to press you to another muffin.
You see, I was right. You have used this pretense of proposing to me as a pretext for pressing me to a muffin. I think it hopelessly romantic of you, and am quite determined to accept.
You are? Oh, Harriet! Which one will you have? This one here has been lightly buttered.
I think I might venture this one to the far side of the plate.
Harriet! Remove yourself from that muffin.
Lady Carmichael, Arthur.
My dear Gerald, muffins. Going a bit strong, old boy. Lucy is my cousin, you know.
Arthur, you will see Harriet to the dispatch area.
Mama!
The dispatch area, Harriet!
I will not forget this, Mr. Cunningham. I shall await you. Bring some more muffins to press me to.
Angel.
Harriet, the dispatch area.
Come along, cousin Harriet.
Don't say cousin in that odious tone, Arthur. The word cousin is like a buttock. Use it too much, and what have you to fall back on? Use it too little, and...
Harriet is a delicately nurtured creature, Mr. Cunningham. I cannot allow her to be pressed to muffins without first knowing something of the gentleman who is doing the pressing.
Lady Carmichael, and no doubt you think my behavior inexplicable.
No, I do not say that. I find the word hebelfrin inexplicable. That I will allow. Your behavior, however, is like a bad underpant. Transparent and unclean.
You think it is wrong for a man to press a woman to a muffin, perhaps?
Wrong? Wrong? What have I to do with right and wrong? I am not an omnibus, Mr. Cunningham.
They are very good muffins.
Well, that I have no doubt. They appear to be excellent.
Do feel free to avail yourself of them.
I may perhaps be granted the indulgence of one.
Lucasta, put that muffin down.
Aunt Valeria.
Lady Bellingham.
Mr. Cunningham, I'm surprised at you. Lucasta, await me in the loading bay.
But Aunt Valeria...
The loading bay, Lucasta.
Very well. Pray stand up, Lady Bellingham.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham, but I prefer to sit.
As you wish. Oh dear!
You appear to be amused. What can be the cause of such indelicate merriment?
I have just realized that this plate, these are not muffins at all. Meridew must have misunderstood my most particular orders.
Not muffins?
No!
Then what are they?
Well, they are. Well, right, they are. Can you look at me?
A full 2 minutes, and then she just keeled over.
God, what did you do?
Well, what would you have done then?
I'd have hit her.
No, you wouldn't. You just have to say that, don't you?
I would. I'd have taken them out of her mouth and then hit her.
Well, how would that have helped? You'd still be two tubes of hair gel down on the deal. As it happens, I didn't hit her. I just cut my losses and climbed out.
Tape's gone down again.
What?
Oh, yeah. God.
What is the matter with that bloody machine? Well, we seem to have lost that programme. For the moment, we're doing everything we can, and we'll return you to it just as soon as possible. Meanwhile, here's some music.
Cool Britannia, Britannia, you are cool. Take a trip, Britons ever, ever, ever shall be. Hip, hit me, hit me.
Mum, I can't go to the disco with my shirt like this.
Mum, I've spilled gravy on my shorts.
If you'd seen my two, you'd know that when it comes to a powder, I have to have the best.
Darling, I've got muck, sweat and worse on my tea vest. It's ground in dirt.
Powder that goes on working. Because with a family like mine, an ordinary powder isn't good enough.
Mum!
Mum!
Darling!
So the powder I use is the best.
Mmm, that's fresh.
He noticed.
Wow, that's fresh.
He noticed.
That is fresh.
Even Tommy noticed. That's my powder. From the natural coca leaf grown high in the Bolivian hills. Simply tap, unwrap, chop, and sniff. Because with a family like mine, only the greatest powder has the greatest power.
Well, gentlemen, that's the campaign.
I see.
May I ask who's responsible for copywriting this advertisement?
Well, these things are basically a team effort.
That's right, yeah, team effort. Team effort. Teamy, weemy, efforty, wefforty.
And you think this is acceptable?
Ooh! Acceptable!
Acceptable!
Bractel is a good powder. We take it seriously.
It's good, is it?
It is excellent.
Give us a line, then.
A what?
A line. Line. Let's have a snort of it. See just how good it is.
A snort? A snort? We hired you to write a campaign for Bractel, the powder with the power, not to snort things.
God, well, this is terrible stuff. Where'd you get it?
You're not supposed to sniff it.
Not sniff it?
Of course not. You put it on your tongue, like this.
Oh, yeah, wow, that's fantastic.
Hey, not bad.
Quite a kick, isn't it?
Right.
So you can see a campaign based on sniffing. It makes no sense.
Yeah, sorry about that. Well, we'll get on to it right away, yeah?
How about Bractel can lick it?
Yeah, nice. Or give it tongue.
Now we're getting somewhere.
And as the overture to Wagner's comic masterpiece, Die Meistersinger von Nürnberg, fades away, there's just time for a brief word from the team. Alison.
Soil. Soil.
Good. Your brief word, Jim?
I've chosen tit. That's tit.
Hugh.
My word is vilm. Vilm.
Vilm? What does that mean?
Vilm. Vilm.
Yes, but what does it mean?
Vilm. Vilm.
Well, we'll leave Hugh there saying the vilm. Word vilm. And until the next time,
film.
This has been Saturday Night Fry, written and presented by Stephen film. Fry, starring Hugh Laurie, Jim Broadbent, and our very special guest this week, Alison Steadman. Additional material by Ian Brown and James Hendry. The name Hecate Carbide appeared by kind permission of my mother. The show was produced by Dan Patterson.
Now, if you ever want to get a fish in your eye, just mention a Saturday Night Fish Fry. I don't care how many fish in the sea, but don't ever mention a fish to me. It was rockin'.